Thank you so much for inviting me to present such result on OSIRIS-REx. So there are many people involved in this mission from INAF. So there are the group of Firenze, the group from Padova with Maurizio Paiola, and the group of the Observatory of Rome with Elena Mazzotta Epifani and Elisabetta Dotto. So we are just in the very important phase of the mission. So this is a separate mission for the people that doesn't know about the OSIRIS-REx. So is a NASA mission, and with the PI is Dante Lauretta from the Arizona University. And so there are many other groups and people from US, many from US. So the Italian scientists participate such a mission as a scientific support. No hardware was delivered from our country. So it's just pure US mission. It's OSIRIS-REx is the third New Frontier mission from NASA. So we have probably heard about the New Horizon that flew through Pluto in 2015, and now it's on the way to this the most distant object beyond Pluto. So it's it's a very interesting mission because it's going to explore the age of our solar system. Juno is another New Frontier mission that is orbiting around Jupiter, and OSIRIS-REx. So OSIRIS-REx is currently orbiting around Bennu asteroid, and is going to take a sample from the surface and return to the Earth in 2023. So was launched on 8th September 2016 from Cape Canaveral. I was lucky to attend this launch. It was really exciting, as usual. After a cruise was arriving in 2018 to Bennu asteroid. So we have starting from August 2018 up to now is doing the operation around the asteroid in order to collect as much as data as possible in order to study the object, so understand the origin, the properties, the composition, and so on. But also, very important task is to identify the sampling sites where to collect the sample to bring back on the Earth. So the sample collection will be done in the fall, I would say, this year. So it should be in September, October. It depends on some aspect, because it was, I'm going to show you, was not really easy to find a place where to collect the sample in a safe way. And so after the collection successfully proceed, so the spacecraft will return on the Earth, and so in 2023 the sample should be back to the Earth and to be analyzed by different laboratories around the world. OSIRIS-REx means is an acronym of Origin Spectral Interpretation Resource Identification Security Regolith Explorer. So there are many objectives, scientific objectives that are beyond this mission, and I'm going to show you so the major one. So one of these very important objective is the as I said, the return of the sample to the Earth, and especially so it's planned to return between 60 gram to 2 kilos of sample. So it's the largest amount of sample returned on the Earth after the Apollo mission. So I would like to remind that another mission that is a NASA mission is a Stardust that was organized and launched successfully brought back on the Earth teeny grains of comet Wild 2. So it's a really very teeny amount compared to grams or kilograms that should be returned by OSIRIS-REx. So with such amount of material, many destructive and deeply investigating analysis can be performed. So another objective is to map the global properties of the asteroid, so in terms of chemistry, mineralogy, and so characterizing the geology, the dynamic history, and so having a better view of those kind of objects, because as we will see shortly, is really one of the asteroid that is dangerous for the Earth. So it should be it belongs to a sort of a family that can have a close encounter with the Earth, and so knowing that then the properties, the physical properties of the asteroid, this is a really important aspect in order to deviate its trajectory, in order if any collision we hope no, but can be occur, I mean, with the other kind of asteroid. So another objective is to document the texture of the asteroid, morphology, the property of the regolith, so the dust and the grain, the boulder that are on the top of the surface. And the fourth objective is to measure the Yarkovsky effect. It's an interesting effect that occurs when on a small object that irradiate the solar power, I would say, that is colliding on the asteroid, is irradiated as a thermal radiation anisotropically. So in this way, according to the way in which the asteroid is rotating, it should be a sort of an increasing of rotation, or it should be slowing down. So in this way, I mean, is a very effective effect that is governing and affecting the trajectory of such object, and so it's important to understand how it works. I mean, and try to have this grown through. Another objective is compare the data that the asteroid is giving to instrument that is on board of the OSIRIS-REx, and compare with what has been observed from the Earth, from the radar with the telescopes. Okay, why we want to bring back samples from such kind of object? Because I would like to remind you that those asteroids are the remnants of the building blocks that formed our solar system. So the solar pre-solar nebula collapsed, and so the grains and dust and ices and volatiles were collected in a boulder in small grains that increased up hierarchically or colliding, and so formed the planetesimal. And so such object since didn't ended up with the formation of a planets, they have maintained all the properties the properties that they had originally when the solar system was formed. So there are some alterations that they suffered during the history, but surely they kept the majority of the material in a pristine way. So studying in laboratory those objects is a way to see our history and have a recorder of what happened during their evolution. So we have also on the Earth the meteorites that are also fragments of asteroids, but the meteorites, as you know, are quite altered in some way. I mean, altered due to the entry on the atmosphere and in the case of very fast collected meteorites, so we have surely a pristine material, less altered, but it's not really simple to find such kind of meteorites. So collecting a pristine sample coming from an object like this one is a way to have a very uncontaminated sample to be analyzed. So this is almost the history that we have behind us, so we can also find the pre-solar grains, so in the sense that as you know, some grains are of interstellar origin that were injected in the interstellar medium from supernova explosion and novae explosion. So was those grains were collected and ended up in the formation of such object. So we have in this way we have the chance to analyze also the history that was before the formation of our solar system. So the asteroid exploration was a new field, I would say, because it's not really many mission has observed the asteroid. Those represented in this view graph are really the object that has been analyzed. As you can see, there are different kind of morphology, sizes, and so on. So according to these properties, they are telling us a different kind of history. So it's really a very exciting and fruitful field. So many other missions are planned for any further kind of asteroid. So because each of them are really telling you something new. So it's a newer discovery, because it's not possible to see such a detail from Earth-based or even space-based telescope. Those are the very recent mission. So two are from Hayabusa, Hayabusa 1 and Hayabusa 2, that are from Japan, and the OSIRIS-REx. So we also proposed years ago a European mission that unfortunately was not selected, so it was Marco Polo, but it's another story. So unfortunately Europa doesn't have any sample return mission from an asteroid. Okay, so this is more or less the history of the space missions to asteroids, and so you can see more or less which is the situation. So I don't want to go to the detail. So why Bennu? Bennu is a stay at the top of this pyramid in which we discovered more than five 100,000 asteroids, but it's thought that 1 million, 2 million of asteroids are in the main belt. Those asteroids, 10,000 more or less, are near Earth asteroids like Bennu. So those are asteroids that are orbiting around the Earth. So with the same distance, more or less, of the Earth, one AU. So from those, not all of them are really easy to be reached by a mission. So it's much easier to go to Pluto than a near Earth asteroid. In some cases, they are going very fast, and so it's not easy to catch them. And so from those 200, more or less, have optimal orbits for sample return. And so also there is a constraint on the diameter in order to have a possibility to collect the sample from the surface. And the objective was shown, so we want to we are interested to carbon rich, so very asteroid rich in carbon, so because we want to know if they contributed on the origin of life on the Earth. So because as you know, in the first 500 after 500 million years that the solar system was formed, that the Earth was bombarded, that was affected by a late heavy bombardment of such small objects, and so it's thought that they brought the water and the organics on the Earth. And so it's interesting to know the organic and chemical composition of those asteroids. So just five are suitable for a sample return mission, and among them, Bennu was the top, was chosen. So this is more or less the orbit of Bennu. It's belong to a so-called Polana family, and it was a second generation orbit. Asteroid, sorry. This is more or less the size. It's less than 500 meters, more or less compared to the Empire State Building or the Torre Eiffel. It's a carbon rich. So this is the spectra that was obtained from the Earth-based telescope that are telling us that they have a very low reflectance, so very low albedo, and so it means that they are rich in carbon, and they belong, so Bennu belongs to the B type, so it's a very carbon rich asteroid. So it's really an excellent target that you study all of those facts that has been presented. So this is the imaging of Bennu. As you can see, it's not just a sphere, but it's top shaped, as I say, the diamond-like shape. It's really very, it's a rubble pile, so it's made of boulders and rocks and pebbles, and so it's really a collection of an object that was really destroyed in a previous history. So it's 492 meters. The density is 1.2 gram on centimeter cubic, and so the mass is 8,010 kilogram. So there is many observation that has been made, and so studying the slope distribution, the heights of the boulder, and so on, that are necessary to understand really the formation of those objects, but in particular, as I told you, is necessary to identify the places where to collect the sample. So there is the rotation period is 4.3 hours, and so it's really a good one in order to have the possibility to land and collect the sample. Otherwise, if it's spinning faster, is really impossible to land, but it's not, as we will see, it's not really a landing, but it's a touch and go, a few seconds spending on the surface to collect the sample and bring it back on the Earth. Okay, so geometric albedo very low, for a few percent, I would say, and also the inertia thermic. Thermic is really low, so it's something that should be compatible with a very porous or dusty object. So it means it's more or less like the sand on the beach and the seashore, and so it's really easy to warm up and cool down. And again, compared with the classification that we use to classify such object, this is a C complex, it's a B type. So I'm sorry, it's not really good the definition of this kind of taxonomy spectra. This is the spectra in the visible near infrared. So just very, very simplified. So there are some that are S complex, means they are containing silicates. In this case, there is no the feature of the silicates, and Bennu is just a flat spectrum, very boring, I would say, who is usually used to have very complex spectra. This is a boring, it's a very flat, but it's telling us that it's rich in carbon. Okay, there is a comparison with the meteorites according to the spectral features observed from the Earth, and so there are some correspondence with the carbonaceous chondrite meteorites that are the oldest meteorites that has been found on the Earth. So they kept the very original material. By the way, they have also they have been affected by an aqueous alteration. So water was liquid inside this object, and so altered the material in some way. But they didn't have been affected by temperature. So the temperature alteration was really low. Not really affected the material. So it's a very interesting material to be studied in the lab. Okay, so going to the instrument, there are some instruments that are a camera, a laser altimeter, and two spectrometers, OTES, that's the thermal infrared spectrometer, and the OVRIS is the visible near infrared spectrometer, and also REXIS, that's X-ray imaging. That's really interesting object and instrument, because it was entirely projected and made by student of MIT. So it's really an experiment that the US did, and was amazing. I met some of the students that worked, more than 100 students, because as you can see, to design and made an instrument, it takes decades. So students are usually spend less time as an undergraduate, so the university, and so they were very well managed by a coordinator in order to translate, pass by the expertise that they have acquired during the period that they spent in building the instrument. So it's a really very, very nice instrument. Okay. So this is the basic characteristic. I don't want to go too much into the detail of the instrument. And so, this is more or less the resolution that can be obtained with the camera and with the different kind of camera that are on board. And so we have the possibility to, according to the distance from the asteroid, to resolve very tiny features on the surface at the order of centimeters in order to have a clear map of the what is present on Bennu. So this is the timeline. So now is orbiting, and this is the mechanism to collect the sample. So this is a boom that will be deployed with this sample collecting mechanism that is using especially gas and nitrogen will be injected let me see if it works. And so it will be injected the nitrogen lift off the grains that will be collected inside this torus and return at the back, because this sampling mechanism will be inserted inside the reentry capsule. So this is an imaging of the grains up to 2 centimeters in diameter can be collected, ingested inside this torus. So it's a very efficient way to collect. So this is the gas flow that is going down and keep the grains inside this torus here. Okay, this is some of the images that the mission showed. So there are, as you can see, it's a very rocky object. It's a rubble pile, as usually is called. So you can see a big block of boulder. So this is a Benben, so called Benben. It's more or less 50 meters in diameter, and many other small rocks of different morphology. You can see there are some of them is quite flat, other are more cauliflower in shape. Another example here, you can see there are some other small grains embedded in the big block. And so it means that, or they are, collected because a micrometeorite impacting the asteroid, and so those grains were just heated the blocks, or they are just embedded in the matrix. And it's coming from previous origin. During the parent body history. It's nice to see the diversity of the material. Again, you can see even the albedo is very low, so it's everything is dark here, but you can see that some of them that rocks are showing a higher albedo than the other. So there is a distribution of the albedo that means a different kind of rock composition. This is the temperature of the body. So you can see the temperature is going from 200 Kelvin up to 350 Kelvin degree. So the equatorial ridge is the place in which the temperature is gaining the higher value, and the pole is where the temperature is kept at the lower value. Okay, so the sun also is responsible. So the heating during the day and night thermal variation is responsible of this cracking. So more of the rocks are showing a fracture on the boulder, and so it's a way to produce small fragments and pieces, and so as long as the time is going, the rock are degrading, I mean, it's fracturing and breaking in different pieces. So here is a new result. So according to the history of the object, so it was according to the information that has been obtained from the OSIRIS-REx mission, so it was possible to see that it was made by the destruction of a parent body of a bigger size, more than 100 kilometer, and was destroyed by an impact. So impacts are very important mechanism driving the history of the small objects in the solar system. And so the top shaped morphology of Bennu is really a result of this mechanism. But also you can see that pieces were modeled in terms of the temperature that they gained by the impact. So you can see that our small there are some fraction of the asteroid that in which the fragments reached a very low temperature, so just a few tens of Kelvin, and other that felt a temperature of 1000 Kelvin. So there are some fragments that suffered a very high temperature during this process, and so another fragments that didn't suffer a very high thermal alteration. So, I mean, it's possible to describe the differences observed in the on the surface according to this model. So it's a really interesting history. And another consequence was that the object was originated by a one big parent asteroid and not really by two small pieces that collided and broken up and forming the fragments. Okay, so many observations have been made with different orbital parameter, and so in this case, so different station was chosen. This was the equatorial station at different time of the Bennu day. So during the day, this is during the day, and this is during the night. So spectra, in particular spectra of the surface, was taken at different hours, daily time. And this is important because we are just involved in the analysis of those spectra in order to find some properties. So some area were identified as a possible good one to be where to land and collect the sample. As you can see, the boulder are really too big, and so it's really not safe and not a good idea to land in this region, for example. So there are some craters that you can see here, more or less. And so four of them were down selected as a possible candidates. So they are named as a birds, so, and especially the nightingale was the main site selected for the sample collection. So the primary sample site is nightingale, and the second one is osprey. Here is just to show you this is a sort of crater with a very big boulder. This is the cartoon of the spacecraft. So it's really difficult to land here. So the precision of landing was really improved with respect to what was, planned before the launch. And as I said, it's a new, as always, a discovery. And so that's why there is some delay in the choosing of the place and collecting the sample, because it's not really easy to find the way in which the mission has to land and collect the sample. By the way, as I said, there are boulder everywhere, rocks everywhere, pebbles everywhere. So, but the question is if there is the right size of a sample to be ingested by the collecting mechanism. And so that was another activity that involved a lot the people of the science team. And so it seems that there are the right material, as you can see here. So there are some grains that are that possess the right size to be collected. Studies ongoing in order to evaluate. But we are confident that the grains the right grains are present on Bennu. So this is the maneuver that will be made in order to take the sample. So as you say, it's just a touch and go. So a few seconds will be spent on the surface. Once the material will be collected, the mission will go away immediately and placed in a safe orbit. So it will be also analyzed and verified if the sample was really collected. So three different tentatives are foreseen to collect the sample. So if the first fail, so there are other tentative that can be done. Here is a first trial to go to the place where to collect. It was not really a landing, but was just a tentative to collect. As you can see, in this case, it was not really right. The right way, because it's going directly to a boulder, and so they are going a different kind of such maneuver in order to verify the capability to choose exactly the place where to collect the sample. And it was made in April 14th April this year. Okay, so going to the science, in which also I'm personally involved. So the composition of Bennu was obtained. This is OVRIS, so it's the visible near infrared spectra. You can see here very deep Big Bang, deep band at 2.7 micron, that is due to hydrated silicates. So this is a OH stretching band. It's the hydration that are affecting some of them silicates, so even on the Earth. So it's really well present everywhere on the notice band. So it means that all the material that we saw, it's hydrated. So this means that an aqueous alteration occurred on Bennu. And it's really interesting to compare this band with some of the carbonaceous chondrite that meteorites that we have on the Earth. And so you can see that there are some differences or some similarity according to the different meteorites. So each meteorite has a different petrologic composition, so it's really interesting to compare. So moving to the mid-infrared and thermal infrared region, we saw these two big bands. So again, it's compared with the meteorites, and quite, would say, good in some way comparison was made, an agreement with the CM and CI meteorites. So it's really carbonaceous chondrite, aqueous alterate meteorites that we have on the Earth. But it's probably there will be something new that will be discovered when the sample will be bring back on the Earth. So this is just a measurement that has been done in the laboratory, just to have a matching of the spectra with what also was observed with the instrument. So in Arcetri, we have these devices in which we can measure the spectra of different meteorites or minerals, especially at different temperatures. So this is a cryostat that is interfaces with an infrared interferometer, but it's going from a visible to near infrared to the far infrared range. So we can measure, here is where we place the sample, and so we can measure the spectra at different temperatures. So we can see this is some of the meteorites that has been chosen has candidates and good analogs that are found on Bennu. And so you can see the temperature here, we are going from 65 Kelvin up to 350 Kelvin. So you can see that as the temperature is going down at the this band, that is the Restalin band. I don't want to go to the detail of this one, but it's the major band, this two one of the silicates. So it's the silicon oxygen stretch and bending band, so it's identifying the composition. So you can see here that as the temperature is going down, so the intensity of this band is increasing. So we can have different kind of analysis in this respect in order to measure the spectra at different temperature on Bennu, and so this is what we are doing right now. So spectral indexes. So we have more than 5,000 spectra that has been collected with the OSIRIS-REx. So we analyzed 1,149 minerals spectra and almost 300 meteorite spectra, and so we measure for each of them 107 spectral indices. So they are a way in which we can identify the bands, the spectral bands that can be diagnostic of the material that is present. Here is just showing a false, a positive, a negative, and false positive comparison of different kind of minerals with the Bennu spectra. You can see that some of them that is in red here are a good. There is a good match. Correspondence with what observed, so we can in some way infer the mineralogical composition. Here is the meteorite. Again, we can see that CM is the best kind of meteorites that can be represented on Bennu. Okay, another interesting aspect was that was really lucky the team to observe these particle ejection events, and that was more than one observed. So this is the trajectory of the particles that were ejected from the surface of Bennu, and so was really. I mean, here you can see probably the particles that are coming out from the surface. This is the trajectory and the vectors of the particles. So they are coming from one point. So it means that there was some mechanism, probably one rock that was broken, and like the deflagration that is observed on the desert, on the Earth, due to the thermal inertia of the rock and the insulation. And so probably one of the mechanisms could be this one or other, for example, the sublimation of some water or other compound. Many mechanisms suggested volatile outgassing, cometary activity, so the cracking and so on, but also the if the spacecraft with since there is no, I would say, gravity, so the presence of the spacecraft and the variation in gravity can affect and can be responsible for this ejection of dust grains. So, but was excluded at the end. So, but it's not really. I mean, it could be, but it seems it's not the case. And so on. So, some micrometeorites, solar particles event, and so on. But it's really was the first time that it was observed such events. So I'm going to the end of this presentation. So here is the summary. So we have seen that the Bennu asteroid is a rubble pile with extensive diversity, heterogeneity. There is a large scale boulders, but also there are also micrometeor particles, so there is some effect that can induce the production of these small grains on the surface. Probably this is the impact that they suffered due to the micrometeorites. And the thermal inertia is so it's telling us that there is very small grains or highly porous. The material is very porous, also the density is very low, and so it's a highly porous material. And so there are places in which the activity has been observed, and so there is this loss event that is not really compared to something that has been observed. There are recently, even with the Stardust mission, was more and more clear that there is a continuum between the asteroid and the comets. So originally they were separating in new population. One was the comets rich in volatiles and water, ice, and the asteroid that was mainly a rocky body. But now it's clear that there is a continuum. So there, in some cases, the asteroid is a dust-rich comet, I would say, and the comet is a ice-rich asteroid in some extent. And so in this perspective, there are, also the possibility that some asteroid behave like a comet and was already observed from the Earth-based telescope. So they can produce a coma tail, as observed in the comets. So the surface of Bennu is is consistent with the aqueous alterated carbonaceous chondrite meteorites, and so this top shaped is due to the disruption of one big parent body, and also the fraction of the material that suffered the highly intense thermal processing during this impact was measured. So with those summaries, I end with this cartoon in which we do not forget the fact that those asteroids can be potentially hazardous, and so it's really interesting, as you know, how to deflect those trajectory, since it's very incoherent material. It's not like a comet that is a solid, structured body, but in this case it's not really simple to make this. So, and I am at the end, and thank you for your attention. Okay, thank you.